And moving on to another massive business, and the Facebook founder Mark Zuckerberg has apologised to the European Parliament lawmakers for its role in the Cambridge Analytica scandal and for allowing fake news to proliferate on its platform. He was also told of the suicide of Tyrone schoolboy Ronan Hughes. You may remember the 17-year-old from Coal Island took his own life in 2015 after being blackmailed into sharing intimate photos on Facebook. One member of the committee, the Belgian politician Guy Verhofstadt, said Mr. Zuckerberg needed to think hard about his legacy.
You have to ask yourself how you will be remembered as one of the three big internet giants, together with Steve Jobs, I should say, and Bill Gates, who have enriched our world and our societies. Or on the other hand, in fact, a genius who created a digital monster that is destroying our democracies and our societies for the moment. That's a question that you have to put for yourself.
Well, joining us in the studio is Dr. Kevin Curran from the Ulster University's Computer Science Research Institute. Good morning, Kevin.
Good morning, Sean.
Creating a digital monster, what do you think?
Yes, the Mark Zuckerberg apology tour continues. What we had was a bizarre kind of question yesterday, where 60 minutes were taken over by the MEPs, leaving only 7 minutes at the end for Mark Zuckerberg to answer a lot of the questions put to him. And, of course, he only answered a select amount of these. And he got to lead with an opening statement where he highlighted the safety check for helping in terror attacks that Facebook provides, the way it helps refugees keep in contact, the way it helps small businesses. He did then reply to some of the questions, saying that they're doubling the people working on security and moderation of content to about 10,000 people by the end of 2018. And he does note that that will impact our profitability, and he says the right words, saying that safety is their priority. And then he was asked about the things like this Cambridge Analytica affair, where 84 million profiles were scraped for data, saying that that will never happen again. Well, that could not really happen again because of the controls they've had since 2014 and that the way the data is now restricted. And then he mentioned about the forthcoming Clear History tool, which allows people to remove anything that Facebook has in them. And he apologises for being slow to spot the meddling by the Russians in the elections, and saying that since then they've improved in elections in France and in Germany and Albania. Then he also mentions that they have removed millions of fake news accounts, and then they have this recent creation of transparency with the advertising tools on Facebook. So he did reply to some of the questions, but he really has just such a short part at the end, and some of the MPs were really angry about the way that they didn't get their questions answered.
Yeah, the platform, as you mentioned, there seemed to be where most of the questions were, you know, asked afterwards in terms of how he performed. And I think, in fairness to him, the European Parliament clarified that the way that the questioning was structured was decided upon so that the MEPs had more time for themselves to speak. But it did make it difficult to get answers from him. And I guess most people will be waiting for actions as opposed to words, won't they?
They will indeed. Yeah, and there was a lot of overlapping questions. They didn't even get the questions lined up, really, agreed among themselves, really. So he had another platform, really, to put forward, you know, what he wanted to say. He knew what they were coming. Again, you know, we had people like Dan Dawes asking again about why aren't third-party organizations used more to educate people on online safety. Nigel Farage, who opened up boasting that he had the most followers of all the MEPs.
And he criticized as well Facebook's right, what he perceived as a sort of a liberal bias against right-wing parties, didn't he?
He did indeed. He said, would you accept that Facebook's not a platform for all ideas, that is not impartial, because, of course, that the right are getting hit by what the content moderation, which is coming along. And again, related to that, Facebook now claim that their AI tools or artificial intelligence tools can flag 99% of Al-Qaeda, ISIS content before it is flagged to them. And also, again, that they said that now they have a response to self-harm on Facebook Live. They've got it down to less than 10 minutes. So again, quite often he just kept repeating back all the things that Facebook are claiming to do to address a lot of the concerns that people have.
And obviously he has a big job on his hands, in fairness to him, but has this impacted at all in how people use Facebook and the numbers and their business model? Are they still going from strength to strength?
I mean, there was a delete Facebook campaign after the Cambridge Analytica story blew up again, but that is we won't really see the fallout from that till the next quarter's profit accounts released. But all we know is in the last period they had a £5 billion profit again, that they control a significant chunk of the advertising, which is fast moving online. They are a huge, one of the five giants of the internet. Anyone leaving what we really think is only a drop in the ocean, that there's more people joining every day than ever considered deleting Facebook.
Okay, Kevin Curran, thanks very much for coming in and speaking to us. And we'll have more on this with the DUP MEP, Diane Dodds, who challenged Mr. Zuckerberg about the death of Ronan Hughes, and that's just after 8:30.
Well, like Facebook, is something most of us use every single day, but it's now emerged that Google is helping its users to uncover the